Assalamu alaikum. May peace be upon you all, and still good morning. I'm here to share with you my thoughts on returning to this constitution's path of moderation. Our nation seems to be undergoing some turmoil or turbulence in the area of race and religious relations and in our partnership with our sister states of Sabah and Sarawak. It was not always like that. Till the 80s, for about 30 years after Merdeka, we were regarded as a shining example by many nations of Asia and Africa as an exemplar of successful inter-communal relationships. Sadly, we have regressed. But it's not late. It's never too late to repair bridges of friendship, to tear down the walls of separation and suspicion, and to restore the spirit of 1957 and 1963. What was this spirit? This was the spirit of accommodation, of tolerance, of give and take, of compromise, compassion. It was the spirit that everyone should get something and no one should get everything. The leaders of our independence, especially Tunku Abdul Rahman, Putra Al-Haj, Tun Tan Siu Sin, Tun Samban Tan, and later on the leaders of Sabah Sarawak, they had a vision of shared destiny. They understood that unity does not mean uniformity, that a mosaic is much better than a melting pot. And so they crafted some very significant compromises on ethnic matters. But at the same time, the values of constitutionalism, rule of law and democracy were embraced in our constitution. We must bear in mind that a constitution cannot simply reflect existentialist realities. A constitution must look up to the stars. It must have ideals, values, and that's what we did. Our constitution was a balance between the past and the present and realism and idealism. Because Malaya was historically the land of the Malays, a number of features indigenous to the Nusantara were incorporated into the constitution. Very quickly, let me look at them. The Malay Sultanate, Islam, Sharia courts and Sharia law, Malay special position, Malay reserves, Bahasa Melayu, Malay customs and weightage for rural areas in drawing up electoral constituencies. But what is not well understood is that there were some ironclad guarantees for the other communities. The Malay features, the ethnic features of the constitution were balanced with other provisions suitable for our multiracial, multi-religious society with fantastic diversity. We have a supreme constitution. Article 4, Clause 1 says, this constitution is the supreme law of the federation. And any law passed after Merdeka Day, which is inconsistent with it, shall, to the extent of the inconsistency, be void. Now, having a constitution means that we are a constitutional state. We are not a theocratic state. Citizenship rights were granted to everyone, irrespective of race or religion or region. I understand that at the stroke of midnight, when Malaya met its tryst with destiny, 1.6 million non-Malays were granted citizenship. Electoral process allows everyone, irrespective of race or religion, the right to vote and the right to seek elected office, both at federal and state level. Human rights, the chapter on fundamental liberties, articles 5 to 13, is available to all. Federal posts, whether in the judiciary or executive or legislature or on the constitutional commissions, are available to all without distinction of race or religion, except in relation to the Yang di Pertuanagong and the sultans, who must of course be Muslim and Malays. All this talk that you have heard about a non-Malay or non-Muslim cannot be their attorney general or chief justice or finance minister, this is all politics. It has nothing whatsoever to do with our federal constitution. Education at the primary secondary level is free. It's available to all, and you'll all agree with me, education is the best factor for upward mobility. Sabah and Sarawak are different. They have distinctiveness in many, many ways, and understandably the constitution gives them a fair amount of autonomy, special rights in the executive, legislative, judicial and financial field. I know not everything is working smoothly, but we are working on it. The point is this: the constitution recognizes their special rights. Freedom of religion is available to all. Freedom to profess, to practice, and with some limitations to proselytize, to profess your religion to others. Vernacular languages are allowed, even though Bahasa Melayu is the national language. If 15 kids in a school or their parents request that a language be made available to these 15 kids, the law says the school must try to provide a teacher. That's the constitution. Malay reserves are allowed, but at the same time the law says that no non-Malay land shall be used for Malay reserves. And if a certain amount of land is reserved for Malay reserves, an equivalent amount shall be made available for general alienation. Malay special position is hedged by many, many limitations. First of all, Article 153 doesn't only require the Yang di Pertuanagong to safeguard the special position of Malays, but also of the natives of Sabah Sarawak, and also the legitimate interests of other communities. Also bear in mind, Article 153 special position is not across the board, only in four areas: permits and licenses, positions in the public services, post-secondary education, and scholarships, loans and other such facilities. Also, Article 153 says it does not override Article 136. And what's Article 136? A very well kept secret. Article 136 says in the public services there shall be no discrimination on grounds of race. So what does that mean? 153 and 136 together. A constitution must be read as a whole. The overall effect is, at entry point, reservations are allowed, quotas are allowed, but once a person is in the civil service, in the public service, there should be no discrimination. That's what our document of destiny says. Cultural diversity, we are a beautiful mosaic. We are allowed to maintain our cultural names, unlike in some other societies where you cannot maintain your cultural name, you have to adopt more national names. Our dances, our cultures, our music, our food, our dresses, our languages, our religions, we are allowed to keep them. Religious, racial and regional associations are allowed. In 1957, when Malaya began its journey, we were a little bit like the colors of a rainbow. Maybe separate, but not apart. Secularism and religion live side by side. We are not a theocratic country because we have a supreme constitution. At the same time, we are not a full-fledged secular country because we have Islam as the state religion, and the state is allowed to promote this religion. Now, what are we then? We are hybrid, we are pluralist, we are mixed, and I don't think that's a bad way of doing things. Politics of accommodation. 61 years of Merdeka, 2 years before that, so 63 years, those who ruled the country shared power with others. There was a spirit of accommodation. An absence of the kind of zeal, political zeal or ideological purity, that in many other countries has caused a great deal of problem. We use the economy to unite the people. Malaysia was globalized long before globalization. Import-export was allowed. We had an international economy. The private sector, mostly dominated by the non-Malays, the public sector dominated by the Malays, worked closely together to give us prosperity as well as stability. And without doubt, the non-Malay contribution to the growth of our economy has brought us prosperity as well as stability. But dark clouds are over the horizon. I will not dwell on that. I instead want to find out what can you and I as citizens do. Well, first of all, please improve your constitutional literacy, especially of those provisions that deal with inter-ethnic relations. Our constitution, with all its flaws, was a masterpiece in terms of accommodating conflicting interests and trying to walk the middle path. We should at the same time have respectful discourse on how the gap between theory and reality must be bridged, and how the generalities of our constitution should be creatively interpreted to keep pace with the felt necessities of the time. Law can never stand still, the constitution can never stand still, and we need to examine respectfully how the constitution can keep pace with the emerging demands and expectations. We must recognize our diversity as an asset. The diversity, the heterogeneity, the multiculturalism, the glittering diversity that we have, it's not going to go away. Let's come to terms with it. Let's harness it. If our Mukhtar Daharis and Sidiqs and Sochin Ans and Pandelas and Nicole Davids, they could all come together, hold hands and put their heads together, there is nothing this nation cannot achieve. We should recognize that our cultures are intermingled. Most of us here, if not all of us, actually are people with diverse backgrounds, diverse cultural, racial backgrounds. The only problem is we are in denial. We are in denial about our mixed heritage. If we could recognize that the rivers of our life have been fed by streams from many, many cultures and civilizations, then we could begin to see the other, as a close or distant cousin. Replace ethnic lens with recognition of multiple identities. We all stand at the center of a large number of circles of loyalty, not only to race or religion, but to profession, to our neighborhood, to our employer, to our club, to our hobbies. Multiple identities. Let's emphasize that and build bridges with others in each of our circle of loyalty. We must abhor racism. By racism, I mean looking down on other races or religions, having a hatred for them, trying to keep them down. Racism is to be distinguished from racial consciousness. It's all right to want to bring about the upliftment of a group or community or race or religion, not necessarily your own. I could, for example, work for the upliftment of the Orang Asli. That is also consciousness, but that's not racism. There is no need to bring down others. There are two ways of rising in life. One is with your hard work, determination, perseverance, go as high as your wings can take you. The other is try to bring the other down. There is no need to bring the other down. Adopt moderation as a way of life. By moderation, I mean absence of extremism, a willingness to reconcile, a willingness to listen, to harmonize conflicting interests, the middle path. Recognize human rights for all. The timekeeper is showing me the lights, but I forgot to tell them I'm colorblind. My whole talk is about being colorblind. Anyway, I'll compromise with you. I'll walk the middle path. Just give me half a minute more. Recognize human rights for all, not only my rights, the rights of others. The first function of freedom should be to free someone else. Welcome social engagement, but accept differences. There are no absolute truths. Whenever you have an opinion, please accept someone else may have a different opinion. The garden of knowledge has many, many views. It depends on which window you are looking through. While venerating our religion, we must not condemn other faiths. We must not stereotype any race or religion. Please separate the faith from the faithful. There are in every religion, every race, there are good people, people with hearts that are full of love. Don't stereotype. And we must be the change we wish to see in the world. Stand up and be counted. If you are prepared to stand up and say, wait a minute, this is wrong, that will have a ripple effect. Many others will do the same. Don't forget, in the desert sometimes a sand dune grows around a blade of grass. Don't wait for the law to give us freedom. It's not the law that makes us free. It's we that make the law free. And choose love over hate, moderation over extremism, build bridges, not walls. And as you walk through the meadows of your mind, let us confront ignorance with knowledge, bigotry with tolerance, isolation with the outstretched hand of generosity. May God be with you. I pray that the nation is safe in your hands. Thank you very much.